Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prestaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Nitti Namane Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Ascharya Deshatarine Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasati Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare I am very honored and very grateful to be with all of you this evening. And I thank you for being with us. Nupur was requested me to speak something about my journey to India. I was born in 1950 in Chicago. When I was a teenager in the 1960s, it was a time of great cultural upheaval in America. There was the Vietnam War. There was terrible prejudice against African Americans, the rise of the civil rights movement. These things greatly troubled me. And I could see around me, there were people with wealth, with power, with health, with beauty, with fame, with all of these things, but no real meaning or fulfillment in their lives. It seemed like the society around me was very fancy, decorated, empty shells without inner meaning. I became a social activist, a civil rights activist. Sometimes I was tear gassed by the police simply because I wanted to express my will for freedom. Then something happened to me. I came to the conclusion that if I don't change myself, I cannot do substantially anything for the world. And I heard the words of Mahatma Gandhi that we must be the change we want to see in this world. And I could understand that was a spiritual transformation that I was really looking for. But there was a problem, because I saw among so many religions so much hatred, envy, and violence. Why even talk about religion or spirituality? But as I went deeper, I understood that it's not religion that creates division in this world. It's ego. So I wanted to dive deep into what is the essence of all the great religions in the world, because I believed that could transform it. To love God and be a compassionate instrument of God in whatever we do, I believed was the real purpose of life. And I studied, and eventually I traveled to other lands. I traveled throughout Europe studying Christianity, Judaism. I got a call after months of prayer a voice in my heart spoke three words, and I knew on the top of a mountain in the island of Crete in Greece, if I follow these three words, my life will never be the same. The words were, go to India. I believed it was the words of God. And I left my cave in the island of Crete and left my friend and alone began hitchhiking through Turkey, Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, after hitchhiking through all of Europe. Hitchhiking means standing on the side of the road with the thumb out, begging people for a ride. After 6 months of diseases, death threats, and all sorts of incredible experience, I arrived at the border of India. I had such anticipation. I would meet the yogis, the lamas, the gurus, the sages, go to the holy places. I'm now only a few feet away. Covered with dust, trampled down by my experiences, I handed my passport to the immigration agent. She asked me a question, the one question I prayed she would not ask me. How much money do you have? I looked and collected whatever money there was. I remember it was 26 cents in four currencies. She growled at me and said, you need $200 to enter India. We don't want any more beggars. We have enough. Go home. I was in that no man's land between Pakistan and India. I didn't have a visa to get back to Pakistan. They wouldn't let me in India. I pleaded, I begged. The border security screamed at me and eventually put their guns in my face and told me go. But there was nowhere to go. I sat under a tree for 6 hours until the border changed guards. And a Sikh gentleman, he took the position. I approached him. He looked at me and said, my superior officer has ordered me to reject you. I begged, I pleaded, I cried. Just give me a chance to seek the treasures of your great country, and I promise you someday I will do something good for India. He looked at me very deeply in my eyes, and took my passport, and then spoke words I'll never forget. He said, my superior officer ordered me to reject you, but sometimes a man must follow his heart. I'm going to give you the chance you've been crying for. And he stamped my passport, put his hand on my head, and said, my child, welcome to India. I traveled to the Himalayas, I studied Hinduism, I was studying Islam, I studied Buddhism. That's the story of my book. Eventually I found this path of bhakti, or devotion. When my beloved guru, Srila Prabhupada was in London. A British gentleman asked him, "Why have you come to England?" And Srila Prabhupada said that the British came to my country, India, conquered it, and took away all of our treasures. But you forgot the most valuable of all the treasures of India, our spirituality and our culture. I have come here to England to give all of you what you forgot to take. I was watching these bands playing rock and roll music, and I was just meditating at, as I was sitting among all of you, how one of the greatest revolutions for a positive purpose in the history of rock and roll was inspired by the culture of India. The Beatles, who were the greatest rock and roll, most famous people of the time, they were inspired by meditation and yoga and lived for some time in Rishikesh. And George Harrison became a devotee of Krishna, was chanting Hare Krishna mantra in his records. And his music was so heavily influenced by the sitar maestro Ravi Shankar. At that time, rock and roll was known for revolution, anarchy, sensual experience. But that all changed. He did something that actually opened the doors to change everything. With the inspiration he gained from his association with the culture and spirituality of India, George Harrison did the first charitable benefit in the history of rock and roll. Inspired by Ravi Shankar, the sitar maestro, and Srila Prabhupada, he saw that there was a great disaster in Bangladesh, and one of the greatest concerts in rock and roll history was the concert for Bangladesh. He brought many of the greatest, most famous musicians of the time to play for free in a spirit of compassion. Not to take, but to give. And he considered that one of the most fulfilling, important things he ever did in his life. More than making hundreds of millions of dollars or becoming famous is the joy of giving. This is the greatest need in this world, integrity. And the great culture of India, people are coming from all over the world, and they have throughout history, to find that foundational principle of spiritual fulfillment and integrity. Yoga is now one of the greatest, most successful industries in the world. Kirtan is spreading all over the Western world as one of the very popular forms of music. I'd like to tell you one story that very much affected me when I was a teenage boy living in Chicago. There was a lawyer. His name was Easy Eddie. He was such a powerful, proficient attorney. Everyone wanted him. The mafia, headed by Al Capone, gave him a massive amount of money to be their lawyer. By his powers, he kept the heads of the mafia out of prison, whatever they did. He had a beautiful home and a property about a block in size. He had the best of cars, airplanes, and he had a son. And after giving his son all these material things, he realized in his heart that there's one thing I have never given my son, an example of integrity. And the only way I can give him that is to tell the government what I know about the mafia. If I do it, I will die. But for my son's sake, to give him this example, I must. He testified in courts, and with his testimony, the leaders of the Chicago mafia were put in prison. Shortly after that, while going through an alleyway in his car, he was shot dead with machine guns. He died willingly to give his son what he considered what was actually important, an example of integrity. I'll tell you another story. There was a young man. His name was Butch O'Hare. During World War II, he was in the Air Force of the United States. The great battleship, the U.S. Lexington, with thousands of soldiers, was in the Pacific. And he, with several other planes, went for a battle. But he saw that they forgot to put proper fuel in his tank. So he was told by his commander, "You can't go with us, you must go back." So on his way back, all alone, he saw 9 enemy Japanese planes going full speed to bomb and destroy the Lexington. He could have just kept flying, but he went right toward those 9. It was an impossible mission. He fought against all of them simultaneously. About 4 of those he shot down. He ran out of ammunition, and then he started flying at the other planes to cut off their wings. And the surviving jets, they understood this man is mad, and they all flew away. He saved the boat. He was given the highest honors of anyone in World War II. Congressional Medal of Honor for his bravery, and one of the largest airports in America was named after him, O'Hare Field in Chicago. He was willing to sacrifice everything for others. What I find very interesting is this, and please listen carefully. Butch O'Hare was the son of Easy Eddie. This is the power of the example of integrity. And if we extend that to the deepest level, we find the great gift that India has for the world. The Bhagavad Gita, there's a beautiful verse. Krishna says, Vidyavanaya Sampani Ramadika Vihaskari Suni Chaya Supakicha Pandita Samadarshana. That means that real wisdom, real knowledge, is not just about getting bachelor degree, MAs, PhDs, or somehow or other accumulating massive data within our brain. Real knowledge is the ability to see every living being with equal vision. It is the Atma, the soul within the body, that seeing with them through our eyes and hearing through our ears. The body is like a vehicle. The living force is who we are. When we understand our own spiritual nature and our own relation with God, then we can see every living being as our brothers and sisters, whether they are male or female, black or white or red or yellow or brown, whether they are Hindus or Muslims or Christians or Jews or Sikhs or Zoroastrians or Parsis or agnostics or atheists, whether they are elephants or cows or dogs or cats. Wherever there is life, it is sacred. And this is the knowledge that the world is thirsting for. When there is love of God in the heart, it naturally manifests as compassion to all living beings. And the great culture of India has been teaching the world since time immemorial. And I risked and gave my life to come here to find it. How to live in this world, as the Bible says, but not of this world. To perform our duties, whether we are in business, in industry, as doctors, as lawyers, as housewives, as educators, or farmers. And do our work in a spirit of love, a spirit of compassion to others. This is knowledge. And this is factually the only way we can find internal fulfillment. Finding happiness within is not just about a little meditation or a little prayer. It's a dynamic way of life, to live in a spirit of compassion. And I just want to share with you what I so deeply in the core of my heart believe. It's a message for the youth of India. When I was young, there was a book about a wealthy man, and he left all of his wealth for his only son. But never told his son where it was. His son was so eager for that wealth that he searched the entire world trying to find it, but never found it. And during his journey, he died. They brought his body back to the backyard of his home, and when they went to dig his grave, they found the treasure. This is the story of life. What we're really looking for, the real wealth, is within our own hearts, the eternality of life, of who we are, our relationship with God, and to understand our relationship with our own living beings. Now India is developing economically, scientifically, militaristically, in every way. I was recently at a very high-level conference in Beverly Hills with many of the greatest leaders of all different business, investment, and politics, and entertainment in the world. And the coordinator of the conference was explaining how important India was to the world. And what he was explaining, not just medicine, industry, business, entertainment, and education, but the foundation of Indian culture, which is compassion and spirituality. Please, in whatever you do, build it on the foundation of what your great fathers and mothers and ancestors have given you.
And they need
a life of integrity. And if the young people of India embrace these principles, could create a revolution of peace and happiness throughout the entire world, for sure. Thank you very much.
बंद है क्या? बंद हो गया। बाय आपके आपके पास चाप आ। अरे वो बोला था।